I mentioned three hands last week for the non-dealer. And I mentioned them specifically because the advice we give to non-dealers is that you can't score a triple back-to-back. Well, there's three hands you can do it with. Do you remember what they were?
Three threes and a nine. And three deuces and a ten.
We leave the 10, get a 20 and a 22. The person, they'll work all the time if they've got a double run of face cards. The one that you hardly ever see, and I want to mention, the three threes and the nine is pretty common. But most people lose the pegging potential by playing three. You should try it, because there's 8 or 10 possible pegs there. Close the count with a 31 for 8. You should try it when you have those cards, because all your opponent needs to be handling is a double run of face cards. And you know how often they show up. And the same with the three deuces and the ten. Three deuces and a ten. You see, your first deuce makes you count 22. And that's a goal on a double run of face card, that's a goal. We hardly ever see the three fours and the nine. And there's a reason for that. If you think the three fours, what the reason might be. If I had an ace, I'd keep the ace, wouldn't I? If I had a deuce, I'd probably keep the deuce, taking a shot on that trade dropping in there for that big 17-point hand. Well, if I had a three, I'd probably keep the three fours, right? Something with eight and a chance to cut 20. If I had a five, I had the fourth four, I'm certainly not going to keep three fours and a nine if I got the fourth four. If I had a five, I'm going to keep it with the three fours because I got a chance to cut 21. If I got a six and three fours, I probably will keep the six with the three fours because if I drop the five in there, I got 21. If I got a seven with the three fours, well, I got a dozen going in. Why would I keep the nine? So what it comes down to is, although these cards are equally available, they're not equally visible. And for instance, even if you had the nine with three fours and an eight king, say you had an eight king, most folks would throw the nine king, thinking that's a lower scoring discard, to the crib, than the eight king. But I mention the hand because it won't be often. But if it shows up and you're in a game where you need 8 or 10 pegs, keep the nine with the three fours. If that's the only way it looks like you could win the game, is to score 10 pegs, then try it. Because if you play the nine and they put a 10 on it for 19, you play 23. It's a go if they got all 10-point cards. So if you've got a chance to keep it. But you hardly ever see it. So I wanted to mention that because it's not impossible. Those cards are just as available as those others we mentioned. They just are not retained as often as the others. So those are the three ways that you can, as the non-dealer, get a triple in back to back to back. That's only three ways. The dealer can do it with any set of triples from ones two kings. And you probably have pulled off a lot of those yourself as a dealer. Anyway, we want to cover, I'm going to start here and I'll give you this paper next week. I'm rewriting the paper. There's a couple of things I wanted to add to it that will improve the quality of it. And I want you to five trap. It's harder for the non-dealer to trap a five than it is for the dealer. But there are some hands that allow the non-dealer to trap a five. You just have to recognize it. And of course, the classic one we've mentioned already a few times is 6-6-4 with any card. With any card. It could be a queen. Don't worry about it. If you have the five, you can go ahead and provide it yourself. When the dealer has a double run of face cards, you can go ahead and provide the five when the second six makes the count 22. If you get a 10 on the first six, you're part most of the way home on making that trap. The dealer can't dump the five without getting a trap. If he plays it on your six the first time, you get it for 15 for five. If he hangs on to it till the next time, you get it for 31 for five. So there's no way for the dealer to avoid it if he's got face cards with a five. And if you've got these kind of cards, 6, 7, 7, 10, 6, 7, 8, jack, 6, 7, 9, jack, you want to lead the card. If when a 10-point card is played on it, you can advance the count past 26. So right here, you've got 6, 7, 7, 10 with the lead. You lead the 7. If you get a 10 card played on it, you make the count 27. That leaves the 5 in the dealer's hand. If you play it any other way, the dealer ends up either ditching the 5, or if you make the count 26, you're going to score 31 from 2 with a 5. So you need to start with a card that will put the count beyond 26. And you're playing a hand in a way to take advantage of the dealer when they're holding a 5 with 3 10-pointers, which is a pretty frequent hand. And you can do that with any one of these. And we lead, because we don't want him, see, we don't want to lead the 10 because we pull a 5. We want to trap the 5 later. So we play the larger of these middle cards. In this case, we play the 8. With a 6, 7, 8 jack, we play the 8, 18, 28, roll. And we still got the 6, 7 to pick up the 5. Same with this. We play the 9, 19, 29, roll. And we still got the 6, 7 to pick up the 5. It works a very high percentage of the time if the dealer has like 5 to 10 point cards. Now, some dealers are pretty slick. Some of them get pretty slick and they recognize to drop the 5. But most of them don't like to drop it on this one here. If you lead the 8 and they make 18, they don't like to drop the 5 for 23. So the 8 spot is even a little better than the 7. They figure if we make the count 23, they're going to give you another 2, probably got another 8. But try these, you'll like them. That's about the only way that the non-dealer can trap fives. And the dealer's got a whole bunch of options. And you'll see them. You'll see them here. I mean, the dealer can trap the 5 with a 3-4, with a 4-6, with a 6-7, or with a couple fives. The dealer's going to see the first card and play the last one. And so from hands that look like this, if you pick up a 3, 6, 7, 8, beautiful. You've got the 31 on the first round, most all the time. And you got the 6, 7 to pick off the 5. And 1, 6, 7, 8. If you want to trap the 5, we've got to keep the 6, 7 together. So if you're out to trap the 5, you play the 8. You play the 8 on the person's 10-point lead. Even if it's a 10 spot, if you need 3 or 4 pegs and you're trying to trap their 5, you play the 8 on the 10-point lead, no matter what the 10-point lead is. Otherwise, you get out of there and if you're playing defense with a hand, you would make the count 11. But if you're playing offense, you need some peg, then you would do it that way. Use 6, 7, 8, same idea. Only the small card is not quite as small, but it works the same way. We play off the top of it, keeping the 6, 7 together. Now remember, these are all for the dealer. These from here down are all for the dealer. This little group up here is for the non-dealer. I mentioned this one before, the 2, 4, 6, 7. You can do this, but you have to have the discipline to save the 4-6 in the middle. In other words, the lead is 10. You think, well, the lead in the 10, they might have a 5, but I got a 4-6. So I make the count 17. And when they play for 27, I don't play the 4. I play the deuce for 29. And then you pick up this 15 for 5 with the 4 and the 6. These are wonderful pegging cards for the dealer, particularly in end-game situations. There are other places on the board where they're good, but particularly in end-game situations where you need 4 or 5 pegs, these are really important hands to pick up, and especially so if your opponent is 8 holes or so out, because they got to keep a scoring hand. You have a big advantage if they have to keep a scoring hand. If they're only three points from winning, they can keep anything. But if they need 8 or 10 pegs, there's a good chance they're going to keep their best scoring hand, and a very good chance it'll be a 5 with some face cards. Anyway, that's how that works. And if you haven't been doing it, concentrate on it. Because 4 or 5 pegs on 4th Street oftentimes seals a game. Of course, in end-game situations, the only way the dealer's going to win is by pegging. And if you plan to do it, and you carry out your plan, you'll be surprised how often you can pull it off. Any questions about that? With me. I want to mention if you're going to invest in, not many people are buying books anymore, but all the material is available free. I mean, it all says it's copyrighted, but if you go to the www.scribbage.org, you can print off of there. And of course, there's other websites you can print anything, and it might say down in the corner copyright. The only way you'd ever get into trouble because of copyrights is if you were making money from the material. If you're using the material for your own edification, or even for training your grandchildren how to play this wonderful game, nobody is ever going to accuse you of copyright infringement. So that's why I feel this is available to you on the internet, but you've got your personal copy here, and DeLynn does a really good job of laying it out in kind of a humorous way. And of course, you might consider yourself some kind of a magician when you can pull these 11 out of the hat. But remember that the 2-card 11s only favor the dealer. They favor him in many ways. Remember the 1-9, the 1-10, the 2-9, the 3-8, the 4-7, and the 5-6. And the closer you get to the middle, the stronger they become. The dealer always has the option on 10 cards. If 10 cards are in play, it takes 2 10 cards plus the 11 to make a 31. Most people, if they only have 1-5, are fearful of dropping it, because you can put a 7 on it for 22, and the goal, and you get a goal. So most people are fearful of dropping the single 5 when this is going on. Of course, that's how you avoid making the count 31, is by dropping the 5 into the mix. Because it won't be 31 then. But most people are going to drop 2 10 cards rather than a lone 5. And so, if you're dealing, look for these. And if you're playing offense, I wanted to mention. I mentioned playing offense, defense, or optimal. Well, the old timers said play on, play off. You're playing on or you're playing off. Well, I've discovered since that there are some people that play like they have a transmission. They're in overdrive, or granny gear, or neutral. Same idea. So whatever works for you. I happen to use the terminology that is prevalent in Cribbage Croft, Rex Cribbage, Al Scribb. The strategies are always offense, defense, or optimal. And if you're holding a 5-6 and you're the dealer and you're playing offense, remember you would be playing offense if you don't like where you are on the board. You take the 15 with a 5 and hope the count goes to 25 and then you score 31 with your 6. But if you're playing defense, you don't want to trade 5s with your opponent. You put the 6 on the 10 lead, he advances the count to 26, and you get rid of your 5 for 31 without giving up the common pair. So if you're playing defense, you skip the 15 with a 5 and make the count 60 on the 10 lead. If you're playing offense, you try to get them both. 15 for 2, 31 for 2. 15, 25, 31. So it's important for you when you look at the board to make up your mind on whether I need to play offense or defense. If you like where you are, unless you're playing the game for $100 for a skunk or something, generally, if you like where you are, you would play defense, protect your advantage. If you've got a 22-game tournament you're playing in and you're down to game 22 and the only way you qualify is to get a skunk, and it looks like you have a remote chance to do that, you would play offense, even though the situation would say you ought to be defensive. And the other thing, once we choose our offense, for instance, we hold good scoring cards, and if it's our crib, we try to put something, some building blocks in the crib. See, we're looking at offense both places. If we're playing defense, we're looking at a hand that I can defend in the pegging and a low scoring crib for my opponent. In defense, I'm going to avoid pegs. In an offense, I'm going to try to create situations where I will take pegs. In an offense, I would pair the opening lead. Playing defense, I would skip it. Good to play off the opening lead if you've got an advantage in the game. But sometimes two pegs for you is important enough to chance giving up 6. So you make that judgment. And then once you see the starter card, really important, look at that starter card. How does that help you? You don't know how it helps your opponent. But what did it do for your hand? If you started with 2 6s and a 3 4, and you pitched a queen and a king to your crib, and the cut is a 5, and you decided because of that lousy hand, you were in good shape on the board, you were just going to play it safe. All of a sudden, you recognize you've got 16 in your hand and 4 in the crib. Hey, I'm going to change my strategy now once I see the starter. That's really important. You can have in your mind, I need to play offense. But when you see the starter card, you say, okay, not now. And it could be the other way. You decided on defense. And then the starter card, it's a bummer. You don't see how it helps your crib, it didn't add nothing to your hand. It's offense now, even though you held the hand with the intent of playing it defensively. So understand that you need to be flexible enough that you can make that kind of a change. You don't want to be too rigid when you decide on offense or defense and carry it on through without recognizing the value of the starter card. Of course, to recognize the value of the starter card, you have to remember the 2 you threw to the crib. I noticed somebody last week threw a 6-9 to their crib. 9.
Before they turned it over, I told him we got 6 in the crypt.
How do you know? How do you know? Well, I figured they probably got a king 9 or a queen 6, something like that. You know? Well, they could have a dozen then. But just with what's on the deck, they should have known that they had 6. But if you don't remember that, you may pull some stupid things in the pegging game. If you don't remember that cut on the deck gives you 6 in your grip, you might do some stupid things pegging that you don't need to do. So you got 10 in your hand and 6 in the grip. Dealer's guaranteed to peg. You all know that. Any way you play your hand, you're guaranteed to peg. Has anybody here ever played a three card hand when you were dealing? So you're not guaranteed to peg. In fact, one time at a tournament in Reno, guy had a 7-7-8-8 and a 10 king. And he drops the 7-7-8-8 on the table, plays two cards, the 10 and the king. And the cut is a 6. Well, his opponent didn't have no need for middle cards. So his opponent drops his 2 on top of the 4 he'd already got on the table. Well, what happens to the crib? He's got 147 points in the crib when it's dead. And he's played 2 cards, so he doesn't get the guaranteed peg. So he got a 0. 10 king with a 6 on the board. And he doesn't realize he's got a problem until he gets to his last card. I mean, you're thinking, people get spaced out, but that was the worst case I've ever seen, where somebody could go through that hand and not realize he had a problem holding 2 cards. So it is possible for the dealer not to get a peg. But if you play four cards in this game, you will get a guaranteed peg. So you could figure that, at least that much in your... If your hand is 14, you're guaranteed a peg, that's 15, you got 6 in the crib, that's 21. That's probably a good time to back off and take life a little easy. Good score. So look for these when you're dealing. Now the 110 we mentioned earlier, that the 110 actually does work for the dealer. Like the dealer has a king with 2 tens and a 1. But the non-dealer should never keep that hand. Non-dealer should keep any card other than the 1. Because you can't lead it. You can't lead it. If you lead the 1, you play onto it, and sometimes they get 31 for 8. Any card bigger than the 1 is better to hold with 3 10-point cards. Any card bigger than the 1. You can lead a 2, you can lead a 3, you can lead a 4. You could lead a 6 or 7 or 8, or you could lead from the 10s if you had the odd middle card. But so these just benefit the dealer, these 2. Don't even look for them when you're the non-dealer. You will never figure out a way to make them work. But as a dealer, they work real nice. Now, the 3-card 11s are another story. They work for either the dealer or the non-dealer. They're very nice to be looking for. 119, 227, 335. See that one very common, right? 335, see very often. 10 cards in play. And the 11 makes you 31. It works better for the dealer than it does for the non-dealer. These all do. You see what happens, like, if you've got, say you're the non-dealer, and you've got someplace in here I got some 3s. We got a couple 3s. 2 doesn't matter right now. We got a 3-3 and a 5. A 10. So, K kind of see how that works. Now I'm the non-dealer, so I got the lead. So I lead one of these three, right? Does it matter here which one I lead? Sometimes it might, I just don't have one that matches the suit of these other cards, do I? So we lead the three, and the dealer puts a 10-point card on the three, makes it count 13. So we make the count 16. Dealer goes 26, we go 31-2. Now for the dealer, you see, you make, the non-dealer leads 10-point cards, so the dealer goes 15-2. The non-dealer, then the dealer, non-dealer makes the count 25. Dealer says 28, usual go, 31-4. So the dealer, even with his threes, has a pegging advantage. And the pegging advantage is huge. You'll see some numbers on it before we get too much further along on the difference between the peg scored by the non-dealer and the dealer. 2-1. 2-1. Non-dealer, if they're a very good pegger, gets between 1.7 and 2.0 per deal when they're not the dealer. No crib. I hope everybody's got that in their mind that when I'm talking about the non-dealer, the crib's on the other side of the board. Dealer, the crib is on the dealer side of the board. Dealer, non-dealer. What do you call? Some people call the other person the pawn. And then what do you call yourself if you call them the pawn? They're the pawn, I don't know what are you. It just seems to me that dealer, non-dealer are pretty good terms. And sometime in the printed matter you might see N/D or D, which is just a short way of saying dealer or non-dealer. When you see the ND, always assume the crib's on the other side of the board and you'll always be right. But you see these? Look for them. They're a source of good pegging. And as a non-dealer, anytime you can close the count, that's why these three card 11s are important. Anytime you can close the count on that card you play, that's a good action. You've got two. And very often the best you can hope to do is to try to stay even with the dealer. So if you've got two on the first time through the cards, you've done pretty well already. But look for them whether you're dealing or non-dealing. 5-5-1 you can make worth a lot. You get 15-20-30-1. And sometimes again it works better for the dealer than the non-dealer, because the dealer gets both the 15 and the 31, whereas the non-dealer will only get the end one. These little guys here, amazing how well they work. You got to be looking for them, because this little hand here might be a 1-2-8-4. I mean, you got a fourth card with all of these. If you're the dealer, these work really good. There's 11, 4, 5 and a deuce, 2, 3 and a 6. Makes the count 6 on a 10-point lead. 6, that's a dumb thing, ain't it? Well, it advances the count to 26, which your opponent is very happy to do because they probably got a 5. And you've got the 3 and the deuce for 31. And 1-4 with the 6 works the same way. So look for them. They're there. Some hands actually have 2. You see here, we got a 3 and an 8. That's 11. We got a 4 and a 7. On 10-point cards, if the person's holding a double run, you get all the pegs.
You get 31 with the 3 and the 8, and you get 31 with the 7 and the 4. And in here, you might even get the 15-2 plus 31, and then you might, well, you're probably only going to get 4. Either you can do it this way, if you have these 4. I usually like to keep the 5-6 if I'm dealing. So I'll play the 7 on a 10-point lead, and then close the count with the 4 for 31. And then very often they'll play another 10, and then I get, if I play an offense, I take the 15-2 and hope they got all 10-point cards, and then I'll get 31. So in this one here, I can actually get 6 pegs without giving up any. 31 twice plus the 15. So you can play it however you like. It is possible that if you could do it the same way, by taking the 15 early, but I just kind of like to close the count at 31 with the 4-7 and have the 5-6 remaining. If I'm needing pegs, playing offense. And of course, if you're playing defense, you're going to try to play away. Play away, play away. There's some more of these here. Once in a great while, I do end up with 2 deuces and 2 nines, and that's the reason I keep it. It's all I got. But if I play it a double of the face cards, I get both 31. So it's kind of a chintzy-looking hand. All of these, you see. There's a few hands I want to demonstrate here tonight. They're 4-card 11s. The only person they work for is the dealer. If you're the non-dealer, you just lead from the small triple. There's no way you can get the small triple in, except for those we mentioned earlier. 3-3-3-9, deuce-deuce-deuce-10, 4-4-4-9. As a non-dealer, you can't make these work. Three aces and an eight. If you're needing 10 pegs, it's available a lot of the time. If you're looking for it, you might keep an 8-7 and 2-1s, I don't know, or an 8-7-6 and a 1. But if it looks like the only way that you could win the game is to pegging 8 or 10, take your chance on keeping 3 aces and an 8. Why don't we get through somebody here so we can have a hand here. Could you come over there, Lisa? On the even side of the board, deal yourself 3 aces and an 8. On the odd side of the board, any old run, double run of face cards, 10-point cards, all 10-point cards. Take the two as you score them. It also avoids controversy.
pegs in the side.
I see people sometimes take 8 or 10 pegs, so they got 8 or 10 between their pegs. And the truth is that what's supposed to be between your pegs is the last score scored. So if the last thing you scored was 31, there should be 2 between your pegs. And most people won't say a thing if there's a 31 for 5 and you take 5. But it is better to take the pegs as they occur. In this case, you can take 2 for the 8 there, and then the 3rd one for 6, and the 31 for 2. You got 10 unanswered pegs. And that'll happen any time that your opponent is holding a face card run. It will happen, some of these it'll happen either way, and we'll show you how that works. Let's do this other one. It's pretty interesting because this one, you can make this one work even if the opponent has a 5 with the 10 pointers. So on the outside of the board this time, let's have 3 deuces with the 5. And on the even side of the board, let's have that double run of face cards again, but then I'm going to show you how it works also if you got a 5 with the face cards. So we got 3 deuces and a 5 on the outside of the board, and we got a double run of 10 pointers on the other side. And the double run has the lead. So you take the 15.
He says take the play the deuce, I thought.
So it's 27.
15 to 2.
29. 31.
2
more.
6. It's that's really the correct way to do it. It's not going to get you in trouble as long as they're there. But when you start stretching your pegs out over a longer distance, it's best to remember that the distance between the pegs is supposed to be the last 4 pegs. Last 4 or so on. Anyway, you see how that works. Now the person that has the double run of face cards throws one of the face cards away and substitutes a 5. Same hands, 3 deuces and a 5, but the person on the other side of the board is going to have a 5 with their 3 10 pointers. Any 3 10 pointers is a 5. And that person's.
So if you have 3 10, instead of the jack, again, you'd get a 3. Right. If you had all 3 for that.
Okay.
So there's 22, and you have to say go.
Now you take the 15.
4 is 2.
Oh, yeah.
We're waiting for this
direction. Either way.
I think he's assuming we're flat.
See how that works?
Yeah.
That works either way. You go ahead and pair the 5, or you advance the count to 25. It doesn't matter. If they advance the count to 25, you get the deuces in for 31 for 8. If they take the 15, then you get the deuce 22 and the goal. So you only get 2 pegs plus 6 and 1. So you get 9 pegs, whereas the other way you get 10. So this one here has a whole lot more hands it will work with. If you get it and you need pegs, remember, it only works for the dealer. If you end up with these 3 cards or these 4 cards as a non-dealer, the correct lead is a deuce. You can't get your deuces in back-to-back to that hand. And so it is also with the 8-3-1.
Right.
Now, this is an interesting one here. It works the same way. Remember, these 4 cards total 11. So this, I guess, this does not work like this one. This one here is really a beauty because you can take advantage of any hand that is all 10 spots or 10 spots and a 5. Now, once in a while, if you keep this for pegging purposes, you will give up the third 5 for 6, but the third 5 makes the count 25. And then you play your deuces on out for 10. So, I mean, you gave up a few to get there, but you got your 10 pegs. We won't play this one out, but you can see how it works. On a 10-point lead, you make the count 12.
Yeah.
They put a 10 on it for 22. You say 25. If they got all 10-point cards, what do they got to say?
Go.
Go! Music to my ears. 25, 28 for 2, 31 for 6. Oh, 31, I get two more. 2 for 6, 31 for 2. Wow, 10 unanswered picks. Look for them. You'll be surprised if you're looking for these hands, how often they are available. And the opening lead, this is so critical to the pegging game. Your opening lead sets the stage for is there anybody here who plays chess? Even a good checkers player.
Poorly.
Good checkers player in the crowd. My dad was an excellent checkers player. And he was a much better cribbage player than my mother, although she always swore otherwise. And he didn't know what he was doing. He was just damn lucky. Yeah. But that idea that you were setting the stage for something on down the line. See, like when you put the 5 on a 10 lead for 15, and you got 3 deuces, it's total 6. All you got to pick up is a 10-point card somewhere along the line, and you're going to make that count 27 with your first deuce.
And the 831 worked very good too. But this is a better one. This one here works too. Look for it.
You think you got that? So as a non-dealer, there are 3 cards, 3 hands, and you can get triples in back to back to back. Up, up, up. Deuce, 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 10. 3, 3, 3, 9. 4, 4, 4, 9. As a dealer, you have these 3 here. We'll do the same thing. We close the count at 31 most of the time. You see, I circled that and I skipped over that, but I shouldn't have, because there are some of these small double runs that work very well for the dealer, because they include a 4 card in them. And if I put the 4 on a 10-point lead, I'm the dealer, I put my 4 on a 10-point lead, I do 2 things. I force the 5 off the play. If the dealer has a 5 with 10-point card, is he going to drop it on my 4? No, he's going to advance the count to 24. I say 27 with the 3. Let's go. 31-4. Look for these as a dealer where you have a 4-card 11, or if you can't do it with all of them. If there was 2 threes here, the best I could do would be 30 for 3. If you had 2 threes in here instead of 2 deuces. And I can get the threes in back to back. And I got to force the 5 off the play and force the count to 24. And then I play the 3 for 27 and I get a goal. So I pair my 3 and get the goal for another pay. So if you've got these like that, or similar, look for the opportunity to make the count 14. Sometimes 13 will work. 14 is a lead pipe cinch. I very often will drop my 5 on a 3 lead, thinking that the person's more likely to have a deuce than have the card that fits between the 3 and the 5. So, Try it, you'll like it. I think it's time for a short break. It's almost 7:15. Yeah, thanks for your kindness.